Before we go live, navigating the abusive world of online entertainment. Written by Stephen Flavall. Narrated by Ray Chase. Content warning. As a 35-year-old entertainer, I value some amount of privacy for myself and the people close to me. Several names in this book have been changed and a few have been omitted. However, I also value being able to clearly and honestly communicate about important and sensitive elements in my life. I want to be an honest role model for my audience and a strong advocate and ally for my friends, and I want future content creators to be able to learn from my experiences and mistakes. This book is my attempt to communicate about those sensitive elements via a medium which allows me to carefully review exactly what I say. Many of the topics covered are too serious or personal to talk about during a live show online. The story I have to tell is about people whom I love and ways in which we have been taken advantage of, and I've needed a comfortable and controlled space to allow me to tell it in a way which is useful, evocative, and respectful of all of our boundaries. Because of all this, some of the book is dark and troubling to read. Difficult subjects which were tangential have deliberately been sequestered in a segment of chapters toward the end of the book that contain little plot information relevant to the main story. Chapter 13 speaks about burnout through the coronavirus pandemic. Chapter 14 relates in detail a miscarried pregnancy a friend suffered and her difficulty finding support in the predominantly male strategy gaming space she works in. Chapter 15 concerns mental illness and suicide. While I hope that you will read and empathize with these chapters, I also hope that you will find that the book is wholly readable and enjoyable should you choose to skip them. The main story in this book would have been incomplete without a constant and thorough relating and examination of sexism, abuse at work but also in relationships and families, and manipulation, and these themes were impossible to contain within just a few chapters. You will find elements of them throughout this audiobook. It is my opinion that they are worth talking about, and this book is my attempt to do so. This is for Hannah. She'd like for you to read it, too. Numbers. Sometimes I try to track all the numbers. As of June 2022, I follow 492 people on Twitter, which is far too many people for me to actually care about, and am followed by 8,555, which is even worse. 60,000 people subscribe to my YouTube channel, and 109,000 follow my Twitch stream. The numbers don't make much sense to me anymore. They are too large for me to understand. When I was starting out, I cared about smaller numbers. For a while, I cared about paying rent. I made $3 an hour, I made $4, I made $8. After a year and a half of streaming full-time, I was finally making minimum wage. A couple of years after that, I was signed to a professional team and signing contracts to advertise products to my audience for $1,000 an hour. I stopped trying to distinguish all my followers back when I had a few hundred. At the time, I figured I could meet and learn about 5 new people per day if I really spent energy on it, but in the time it took me to do that, 10 more would have followed my channel. Then it got really out of hand, and I started gaining hundreds of new followers every day. Nowadays, there are people whom I know nothing about who have watched 1,000 hours of my channel and tipped thousands of dollars to me. My friend celebrates her 3 millionth follower. A viewer announces their 60th consecutive month subscribed to my channel. Today, I am streaming Slay the Spire. I am constructing a deck of cards that I can play to protect myself and attack my enemies, and I am using it to ascend to the top of a fantasy spire, battling enemies ranging from tiny lice to charismatic bandits to ritualistic cultists, and slay the corrupt heart which pumps blood into its walls from its peak. I have streamed 5,033 hours of this game, and am the first person in the world to beat it while rotating through its characters at the highest difficulty 7, 8, 9, 11, 14, 15, and 16 times in a row. Today, after almost a month of play without losing, I am positioned to reach 17. One game usually takes me about 90 minutes to play, but in a high-stakes situation like this, it can take more like 3 days. 3 hours to get into my zone, 4 hours for the run itself, full of calculation and strategizing, and then 2 days after to calm down again, to ease my shoulders back from their stressed and coiled hunch, and to be able to feel the ground under my hips again when I lie on my back. To convince my body to sleep for 8 hours in a row, and then if I've won, I'll start the process again to try for 18. There are 4 Slay the Spire characters to master. Each has 75 cards to consider. There are 178 relics I might find and 64 enemies I might fight as I ascend Aspire's 57 floors. My deck of 30 cards has 142,506 possible starting hands, and I have never piloted a deck quite like this one before. The stress isn't about the game. I have 2,422 viewers watching me right now, and when this run is posted to YouTube, it will reach another 20,000. The viewers tend to compare me to three other prominent Slay the Spire players. 12 people have suggested that I should have done something differently in the last 5 minutes. I have been told that I don't understand how to play some of the game's characters and that it's inappropriate for me to give opinions about them. I've been told that my voice is nice and that it's annoying, and asked why it sounds the way it does. I've been told to dress differently, to play differently, to speak differently, to stop trying to be funny, to stop explaining my thoughts about the game, to stream at a different time. I've been told I shouldn't care about winning so much, and that I should care about winning more than I do, and that I should stop playing quick runs rotating through the characters, and instead spend 6 hours per run on the same character for 2 months straight in order to prove that I'm actually good at the game. Thousands of people love me, but I also hear from those to whom I seem arrogant, naive, boring, slow, old, fat, awkward, insecure, and so on. Some of them seem happy to share these opinions of me. As I enter the final fight of the game, one enemy away from 17 wins in a row, messages from my viewers get overwhelming. Dozens of viewers are suggesting strategies for the fight and telling me not to forget certain details, and I can't hear myself think. A moderator decides to set the channel to emote-only mode, so no one can send text messages anymore. With a click of a button, I see the community I've built, where I've spent 10,000 hours talking with my viewers about school and life and a pandemic and wars and charity and love, reduced to a flood of silly image spam. In the end, I can't focus on the fight. I make a small mistake, and it's enough to make me lose. Maybe I would have lost anyway. Technically, I could go back and find out, but I don't care. 17 is not actually one of the numbers which matters to me. I care about trying my best for my viewers, but there are much more important goals than winning at this video game. There are smaller numbers, and those are the most important to me. In my inbox, there are 3 emails from viewers crediting me with huge positive changes in their lives. There's one message on Twitter from an alcoholic asking me for money. There is one DM on Discord expressing suicidal ideation and requesting my help. There are 5 sponsored streams this week that I need to prepare for. And there is one person I trust to make all of this approachable for me. Her name is Hannah, and she's been working with me for 3 years. She has passwords to 6 of my online accounts and access to a bank account, which she uses to manage and pay my 2 other employees and a variety of contractors she hires on my behalf. She reads and responds to emails for me, but she's never been on my stream with me, and the vast majority of my viewers don't even know she exists. This isn't a story about the big numbers. It's about the small ones that Hannah and I deal with while the stream is offline. It's about the unique, bizarre, and dangerous world the two of us have to navigate before I go live. On this day, I have 3,581 notifications on Discord, almost all of which I ignore. As I end my stream, defeated by the Spire, I see that there is one from Hannah in the private server we use to organize everything that I put out into the world. I don't know if I'm about to be invited to fly to Los Angeles to meet a celebrity, or if she's found a contractor for art I'm trying to commission. Maybe a viewer has requested I sign a birthday card for their husband, or her ex has sent flowers to her house again. What I do know is that with this message, this single notification, the other numbers have already stopped mattering. Fade to Karma. To understand streaming, you will also need to understand the organizations that exist behind the scenes. The one I joined back in 2018 was called Fade to Karma. Fade to Karma, or F2K, had been founded in 2015 after a man named John missed a flight. The problem wasn't traffic or misplacing his ticket or getting lost on the way. He simply had a fear of flying and couldn't make himself get on the plane. At the time, John was a professional Hearthstone player, a new thing for him and for the world. Released in March 2014, Hearthstone was an online game heavily inspired by trading card games, but with no physical cards or trading. All your cards were collected in an online account, and you could play against people all over the world with any computer connected to Hearthstone's online servers. It was a revolutionary and immediately successful idea. You no longer had to worry about cards getting damaged or lost. They were all kept safely in your account for you. Cards could have extremely complex effects, because to play them in the game, you didn't need to calculate anything. the online server could resolve everything for you. The cards could have beautiful animations and voice lines attached to them. And when you played games against other people, you didn't have to work to find an opponent at your level or even shuffle your own deck. John took to it naturally, earning $3,700 over his first year on the online tournament circuit and becoming an established face in the Hearthstone community. He had grown up collecting baseball cards and playing somewhat comparable strategy card games like Magic the Gathering and poker. Hearthstone was an exciting blend of familiar concepts he had already mastered, and soon he was holding his own against the best in the world. Eventually, he was even recruited to a professional team. With their support, he'd been on his way to his first in-person tournament, an event held at a live studio to be filmed and broadcast to fans around the world. That is, until the plane had left without him. I'll interject here to say that whatever else I might think about John now, he is undeniably an impressive businessman and born leader. All evidence I've seen suggests strongly that he talks and schemes nonstop from the moment he wakes up until the moment he falls asleep. In typical John fashion, he took this setback, the missed flight, and turned it into an opportunity. Instead of being a professional player himself, he left his team to found Fade to Karma, a brand new professional Hearthstone team. The selling point was simple. He framed his failure to attend the tournament as a failure of the team which had recruited him to properly provide for him, and claimed that F2K was going to treat its players right. F2K would put goodness out into the world, and karma, he claimed, would do the rest. F2K's business model was similarly simple. They signed players whom they thought would succeed at Hearthstone, coached them, and paid for them to travel to tournaments, receiving a cut of any winnings the players earned in return. The team grew slowly but successfully, eventually expanding its goals. Many successful Hearthstone players were streaming their gameplay on services like Twitch and could reach live audiences of hundreds or thousands of people. It quickly became clear that the money available in the form of donations and subscriptions from the audience of a streamer or content creator, someone who wasn't just playing Hearthstone but was also entertaining viewers at the same time, was far more significant than the prize money available at tournaments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.